Welcome. So today we're going to actually talk about how do we build a Bitcoin block. And so this is kind of fundamental to any of the blockchains that you can talk about. Although they build their blocks a little bit differently, at least the concept of how a block gets built, particularly in a proof of work situation, which is what Bitcoin does, is what we'll go into in detail. It's probably been the most covered thing, but if you can understand how each block gets built from a computational standpoint, and what are the steps involved, then it allows you to have more understanding for any type of blockchain that there is this relationship between the pieces. So let's go ahead and go deeper down the rabbit hole. So in a previous course, in a previous class, we talked a little bit about how there's this relationship between the individual blocks and how they're chained together by having a hash from the previous header embedded into the next chain. It also gives us order in time as to which blocks were mined when. The other thing that we keep in mind is that all the transactions for each block has a limited amount of transactions that it can hold, but they get broken up into block after block. And if something doesn't get encoded into one block, it'll get encoded into another block. So eventually all transactions are handled. What we didn't go into before was really how is this built. And so that's really the brunt of this lecture, is building the block. So there's six main parts that we have to think about. And this is the things that miners will put together. And in the mining software, this is actually what you're constructing. So for each block, you're going to start with a version. So what version of the protocol are you using? So as with any type of software, sometimes there are upgrades, and when there's an upgrade that goes across the whole system, everybody has to agree to that upgrade. If they don't, they have something called a fork. And a fork is where not enough people are going to agree to an update. Some people are going to go through with it. Others split off and don't want to do that, and so they do something else. And this is what we saw particularly early on a lot in a lot of the blockchains. You don't see as much of that, particularly like a hard fork where it becomes a completely new protocol, like Bitcoin Cash is a hard fork of Bitcoin. Or there was Ethereum Classic and then Ethereum, which we just call Ethereum now. But that's going to be going to Ethereum 2.0, which is then going to move from proof of work to proof of stake. So anyway, so versions are kind of important so that we understand everybody's using the right software and the right protocol. And those are things that, you know, miners and even validators, they have to make sure that they are running the latest and greatest agreed upon version of things. And so that has to be encoded in every block. The other thing that's next is really the header of the last block. Because remember, we need to chain these blocks together. So what we do is we take a hash, it's SHA-256 hash of the previous block, and that becomes the header for that previous block that gets copied and put into a piece. It's a 32-byte piece here in this next one. Then we're going to add what we call a hash of the Merkle root. We're going to talk about the Merkle root a little more. Then the timestamp. Then there's going to be the target, which is our proof of work algorithm as to what is it that we have to solve, what's our target value. And then the nonce that actually solves that target equation. So let's go through that a little more. So this is a little bit a different diagram, and I really like this version because it puts it out left to right. So And when you look at the block on the top, you have version, the version, 32 bits are reserved for the version, 256 bits for the hash, previous block, 256 for the Merkle root. Then the timestamp is a 32-bit length, 32-bit for the target, 32-bit for nonce. And then you basically have some padding, some extra bits that you have. So really you have two sets of 512 bits that can be used. Now, if you didn't have anything previously, like in a first block, they may have an initialization vector that was a random number of 256 bits to put in. But after that, it all becomes from whatever was in the previous block. So let's go down the line on each of these. So step one, of course, insert the version. It is in Little Endian format. If you're not familiar with that, I encourage you to look that up online. It's basically how you store the data, least significant digit first versus most significant digit first. So little endian is least significant digit first, big endian is the other way around. And that's just a way that you store your bits. The second piece is the hash of the previous block. And we've talked about that before. It's really a SHA-256 of the last block. Now, hashing the Merkle root. So that begs the question, what's a Merkle root? So it's really the hash of the Merkle root is really a summary of all the transactions that occurred. But the way we figured out what we needed to hash comes from the Merkle root structure. So Merkle root structure is basically kind of bottom up. So we could have however many transactions. And in this case, in this example, let's say we had 8 transactions, x1 through x8. So each of those, you separate into pairs. So x1 and 2, we hash the combination of those two. So we get a hash for 1, 2. And again, these are all SHA-256 hashes. We do the same thing for 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, 8. So now we have those things combined. Now we break those down into their pairs and hash them again. So, and then we've got the hash 1, 4, which is really 1 through 4, and then the hash 5, 8, which is 5 through 8. And then the last hash is what we call the Merkle root, and that's the hash of all the transactions. So that's the 1, 4, and 5, 8 hashes. So those are combined where they've hashed. So really, it's kind of like a binary tree, and if you think about the root, it's kind of like it's upside down. But the root is what we're looking for. And the hash of that root, then, again, remember what the SHA-256 hash formula does. It actually makes a fingerprint or an encoding of everything in a one-way direction. So it represents all those transactions and is very specific and deterministic. So that piece gets put in, and that's 256 bits long by definition because we're using the SHA-256. Then we add a timestamp. This is based off of the Unix epoch time, which uses the standard of January 1st, 1970, midnight, UTC or GMT time. And really what it is, it's a counting of seconds since that time. So for example, if I wanted to know what is the number of seconds since January 1st, 1970, when I get to December 27th, 2013 at 2300 hours, 11 minutes, 54 seconds, that actually has a conversion of all of these numbers. And that's the number of seconds since that time. And so this is something used in encoding all the time, just to be able to do any type of timestamp or date. You can always convert back between the number of seconds and convert them back into date and times. So it's our timestamp, 32 bits. The next thing is the target. Now, the target is very important, particularly for proof of work. The target value defines how difficult this proof of work algorithm is going to be. And it's the way we can validate a block. The first one to be able to solve the equation with the given target value typically wins. So target value and difficulty are related. The smaller the target value, the more difficult it will be to solve the nonce inequality. Now, what is the target format? Well, it's actually a hex format. It's a 1-byte hexadecimal exponent followed by a 3-byte coefficient. So it's separated in the Mantissa exponent encoding. So the coefficient, and I color coded these. So the coefficient, the orange is the exponent. So the 0x19 is the exponent. The coefficient then is the number that follows that. And if you notice, a byte is 2 characters. So 03 is a byte. A3 is a byte, 0C is a byte. For those of you who may not be familiar with that. And so that's the coefficient piece. And so the target equation of what the target's going to be, since it changes from block to block, or actually it probably changes every, was it 2016 blocks, I believe? It's a number where the target will change in difficulty over time by making it smaller and smaller. So it's an ever-changing function. So you take the coefficient, you multiply that by 2 to the exponent of 8 times the exponent number here, minus 3. Now, if we were dealing in decimals, then you could solve that directly just like that. However, because we have hexadecimal exponents and coefficients, we actually need to convert either everything into hexadecimal format, or we convert everything to decimal format, convert the hexadecimals. But this is actually all done in hexadecimal format. So we have the target is equal to the coefficient times. Now, if you look at 2 with the exponent, the hexadecimal format for that is a little bit different. And then the exponent is the, if you look at how 8 is x08 times, then we have the exponent there minus x03. So we have everything in hex. And you can solve that and you get this really long number. Now, what you notice is really what that's done is just offset and placed the coefficient somewhere along that line. And so the smaller that number and the more shifted over it is, the harder it gets. So that's just kind of the written out version. This is why you use code. Doing this by hand is really a nightmare. And there's actually somebody who's done that online, which is really interesting to see. Now, this graph over here shows how the target has changed since 2009. So in the beginning, all the way up to 2010, the target was pretty flatline. I don't know if you can kind of see it, but it's this purple line. And then they have some window estimates. But this is the difficulty that's going up over time. The other window estimates are the total computation speed of the network over time. So you can see how the computation speed has gone up. And because they anticipated that, you know, it'll be faster and faster to compute, how then do you keep difficulty? Well, you have to raise the difficulty level. And so you can see how the difficulty level has gone up exponentially much higher than where it used to be. And the actual value then, once you have the target value, that gets inserted in this equation. And this is what is used to, quote unquote, mine this function so that you get this function to be true. If it's false, you got to start over with a different nonce value. And so you iterate with a different nonce value and try again. Doesn't work, get a different nonce value, try again. So the nonce value goes inside of there. So it's really simply you're taking the hash of the block that has to be less than or equal to the target value by iteratively changing that nonce. Now, if you're successful and you get it to where that statement is true, then you have a chance at actually successfully mining the block. And so you have to quickly then build once you have that happen and broadcast that valid solution to the rest of the network. Then the validators come online and start saying, okay, here's the first one that came across, and they said they're valid. If they agree, if a majority agrees that yours was the first valid block, then you get awarded that block and you get so many Bitcoin reward for doing that. That's how the miners get rewarded. Once that nonce is found, a valid nonce, that gets put into the block right there, and then the padding is left over. And all the transactions, roughly a megabyte's worth, gets recorded into this new block with the old hash and now all of this stuff hashed in together. And the reward is whatever the block reward is. Now, currently, at the time of this recording in 2021, and we're in August right now, the current block reward is 6.25 Bitcoins for every valid block that you mine. And roughly of a price of 40,000, you can imagine that's quite an incentive. So that's 240,000 plus another quarter. So we're actually looking at quite a lot of money that you can make per block. The last halving, it should be said, first of all, that the block rewards used to be more, but that's the other thing that happens. Over time, the block rewards go down. So the amount of Bitcoin that is mined over time goes down. And that's where we get this asymptotic curve where Bitcoin's only going to go up to 21 million and then that's it. It caps out. So by these block rewards going down at every halvening, less and less awards are done through mining. And the way it's supposed to be is that ultimately, the miners, instead of getting rewarded by mining, are going to be the ones just running the network, and they're going to get rewarded through some kind of fee structures running the network. So, but the last halving occurred in 2020. And so every halving, you see this jump in price because there's now scarcity. And so the scarcer the Bitcoin becomes, the way that certain models like stock to flow model and things show, that now there's more value per Bitcoin because it's harder and harder to get, kind of representing how it's harder and harder to get gold in a mathematical way. And then once all that's done, then everybody runs on to the next block. And here's the thing, what prevents people from jumping to the next block is you have to have the hash from the previous block to build the next block. So you can't actually cheat the system by just jumping to the next block. You actually have to have the information from the last block to go again. So then all the miners start over and work on the next problem. And that's kind of how it goes over and over again. And I think we're in the thousands of blocks now. It'll be interesting to see as we move forward if the model holds. The difficulty has gone up. Now, what's interesting to be said about the difficulty is the difficulty actually can go back down as well. If the hashing rate or hashing power goes down, the difficulty can also go down. What does that mean? That usually means, like, the prime example right now is China outlawed mining in a lot of its provinces. So a lot of the miners had to get up, take all their hardware and either sell it or move their business to another country. And so what you've seen is all of these mining units that were taken offline. And so you could see the curve was up and then the hashing power took a dive. And what also happened then, and it was a little bit of a lag, was but the difficulty to mine also started going down. So it became easier. It becomes an easier problem to solve to mine rather than a harder problem. Now, what's interesting, and I was just looking at a chart on this, it only took 2 months from that, and that was about middle of May to the middle of this month, where you saw a decline in the growth of the Bitcoin network because all those, because you got to consider, at the time, China was doing at least like 65% of the mining. But with all that getting shut down, it's all moved to United States, to Kazakhstan, other countries, anybody would take them. And now all those miners are getting back online and they're making money hand over fist again. And so the mining, the hash power, hash rates have gone back up again. And they went back into growth mode within 2 months. So even though that sounded like a big thing, when you look at it over time, the hiccup only really lasted 2 months before the network started growing again, which is pretty impressive. That it's that resilient to those types of things. All right, so that's it for building the Bitcoin blocks, and I will see you guys in class next time we meet. Take care.